Chief, you could have stayed there. Good morning, everybody. We're delighted to have you here, and I'm very grateful to have General Welsh with us today to discuss the Air Force here at our Military Strategy Forum. And Chief, this is the first time we've had a chance to have you here, and I'm really honored for that. Thank you. Thank you for coming. You know, I'm always marvel at our system does bring forward the key leaders at the right time. And we're going through really tough days right now. But I've had a chance to watch the stewardship of General Welsh, and this is exactly what we need. We need your leadership and stewardship right now, Chief. And I want to say thank you on behalf of everybody in this audience for what you're doing for the Air Force. Just a little sad news. Jim Schlesinger died last night. Jim has been struggling. He had been up at Johns Hopkins for being treated for pneumonia. This has been a little bit of a continuing problem. But late last night, about 3 in the morning, Jim passed. And we lost a really great man. But I tell my staff, I'm too old any longer to spend my energy on anger and sadness. I just have time and energy for joy. And he was a remarkable man, and we should celebrate that remarkable life. So, Chief, we are grateful that you're here. And I should say thank you to our friends at Rolls-Royce that are allow us to make this program available for the policy community in Washington so that we can hear the key leaders who are shaping our national security trajectory at a very important time. I think the events of the last 2 weeks have brought back a consciousness that this is still a very uncertain, unsettled world with long-term significance. This is not a 20-week problem that we have in Ukraine. This is a 20-year problem. And, of course, this is a chief who, before he was elevated and brought to the chief, was heading up all of our forces, air forces in Europe. And so he has a rich perspective. I would ask you to be careful, however, in this, that we're in a sensitive moment as a country. You know, the chief does not make national policy, the president does. And so I would ask you to be careful on how you ask questions, and I'd ask Kath to make sure she deflects them if they're not the right questions, okay? But you go ahead and try, all right? So anyway, would you please, with your applause, welcome and thank General Welsh for being with us today. Please, go.
Thank you so much, sir. Appreciate it. Thank you, folks, and good morning. Thank you so much for letting me be here. Dr. Hamre, thank you especially for allowing me to join you in the beautiful new building. Pretty impressive. Speaking of great Americans, there's a couple sitting in the front row. You know Dr. Hamre and what he's contributed. There are many others in this room, and I'm just honored to have Dr. Kathleen Hicks here to help me get through this next little bit of time. Thank you, ma'am, for everything you've done to serve our nation and for your help this morning. Folks, if I get the first slide, let me talk to you about the only real policy decisions I get to make. Can I get the next slide, please? I'm not sure how the clicker's working here. We have, as my wife reminds me, 5 long days left in mustache March for our force. My wife has actually given up kissing me for Lent. This has actually been an interesting experiment in lots of ways in the Air Force, but the most significant thing has been that since we started this, the scathing, scalding, really ugly emails that all the service chiefs get every day on whatever the latest issue is that affects your service, I haven't gotten any of them. The only emails I'm getting are ripping me apart about mustaches. I can live with this. We may do this every month. Let me tell you what I'd like to do this morning for just a couple of minutes and then see what you'd like to talk about. What I'd like to do is talk to you about 4 areas that we're kind of focused on right now as we move forward. And let me hit the next slide, please, if I could. First one is kind of reminding ourselves of what it is we do, because I think every service has to do this routinely. And for the Air Force, this is actually pretty easy. Actually, for all the services, it's pretty easy. What we do is what we've done. And what we are going to do is what we do today. Those are the 5 core mission areas. They haven't changed since 1947. They are not going to change in the next 30 to 50 years. How we do them will change. And that's the way we are trying to adjust our thinking. We added one thing to that first mission area from what the president gave us in 1947. Instead of air superiority, we now have air and space superiority. I don't think the president had that space thing figured out back then. But If you look at the rest of them, the wording is almost identical to the executive order that we were given in 1947. The difference is at the bottom of the page. We now do these things in three domains. In 47, it was operating through the air domain. Now we operate in and through the space domain and the cyber domain. And what's changing most dramatically for us these days is that those two domains are getting more contested and more congested every day. And they have to be decongested and deconflicted primarily through technical means as we move forward. And so what we're going to be doing for the next 30 years, I think, is adjusting the ratio of what we do in each mission by domain. So things we've been doing in the air domain for years will shift to the space domain, as you know they already have. We do ISR through the space domain. We do command and control in and through the space domain. In the cyber domain, we're doing strike through the cyber domain. We're doing the global strike mission. We're doing intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. We're doing command and control. All the kinds of things we've done in the air domain, we will do in these other domains in the future. Precision airdrop. We're going to be doing precision drop of data in the cyber domain. We're going to be doing armed escort of data in the cyber domain. Do a little bit of that already, and we're going to be doing more of that. So the ratios will change, which allows us to be more efficient in some ways. It allows us to cost less in other ways. It allows us access to targets we can't get access to create effects we can't create today. That's going to be the change for our Air Force. But these missions are what the combatant commanders in the nation expect us to provide. This isn't going to change. But the way we think about them has to. Next slide. I stole this slide shamelessly from a great friend of mine named Dave Goldfein, who's the director of the Joint Staff. Dave is a really, really big thinker. I am not. So whenever I see a good slide from Dave, I just say, hey, Dave, I'm stealing it. This is actually an interesting concept. I was trying to figure out how to say this, and I heard him describe it. So let me just tell you how he described it. One of the problems we have as an Air Force, one of my biggest frustrations is when we get into budget discussions, or you start reading articles in the paper about capabilities of services. We talk about carrier battle groups. We talk about brigade combat teams. We talk about fighter and bomber squadrons. Well, the Air Force has a whole lot more going on than fighter and bomber squadrons. In fact, most of what we are doing day to day is not fighter and bomber squadrons. It's visible to the combatant commander. Dave said, you know, there's lots of things that we do in the Air Force that are just kind of like the light switch in a room. You walk into the room, the light switch is there, you look at it, you have no idea what's behind the wall. But you know every time you flip the switch, the lights come on. That's kind of the way the Air Force is these days. In areas like ISR, you have no idea that 35,000 people are doing ISR today in support of combatant commanders all over the world. They're running the processing, exploitation, and dissemination architecture. They're doing collection management. They're managing sensors in space and air. They're doing all kinds of stuff. You just don't know what's going on. But there's 35,000 of them doing it every day, and it's flip the switch. You get your picture, you get your SIGINT collection, you get your report. Same thing with airlift. We have 130,000 airmen who do airlift every day, 600 sorties a day. The one question I've never heard asked in a policy or strategy discussion or response to a contingency discussion in the tank, not once have I heard anybody ask, can we get it there? Want to move a Patriot battery to Turkey? Good idea. Nobody ever asks, can you get it there? We'll get it there. We don't ask about getting Special Mission Force to some part of the globe. We don't ask about getting a Ranger battalion to point X or point Y. It just assumed we can. Just flip the switch. Precision navigation timing. Want precision weapons? Better have the United States Air Force and the great folks in Air Force Space Command working. You want to have precise navigation from GPS? You want to have timing exactly right for every mission we do around the world? You better have the capabilities provided by 25,000 airmen every single day, around the clock, running space satellites, running architecture, doing space surveillance, doing missile warning for the nation. All those kind of things are just happening in the background. Same thing with two legs of the triad. Until there's a problem in the force, you don't know anything about them. But they're there. They've been there forever. As we've changed all these different ways of looking at national security over the years, the one piece of national security wallpaper that's always in the background is nuclear deterrence, because they're really good at it. And then even things like air superiority, space superiority, homeland defense. As we sit here, we've got fighters all over the country, mostly manned by Air National Guard members, sitting alert to defend the homeland. Most people don't know that goes on every day. All that stuff costs money, it requires training, it takes people, it's part of infrastructure, it's part of what makes our Air Force the best Air Force in the world. But every time you hear a briefing about DoD capabilities, there is one word on one slide that captures all that, and it's enablers. And one of the keys for us moving forward as a nation, really, is that we start to completely understand that those enablers are now the mainstream of the business we do day to day. They are military capability now. They're not some new thing that's in a back room that's going to help us be better at some other mission. This is the mission. We have 220,000 airmen every single day supporting combatant commanders around the world. They're not bombing things. They're collecting data. They're doing command and control. They're moving people around the planet. They're doing all the enabling things. And that's typically wrapped up in one word on one slide. We've got to break the word out, because it's critical to national defense. You can't do the other things we want to do with all the services unless these things happen. And by the way, there are things in the other services too. This is just the Air Force picture. But we got to understand these if we want to be serious about national security in the future. Next slide. We've been working really hard on this idea of one Air Force. You know, we have three components in our Air Force. In my perfect world, there's only an Air Force. There's no Guard, there's no Reserve, there's just an Air Force, and we do it all. We got full-time people, part-time people, more part-time people. We handle state requirements, we handle national requirements. We could do that, by the way. We'll never will. Politically, that is not an acceptable solution. But if you think of it that way, it becomes a lot easier to manage. As long as you can remove all the rules, the laws, the policies that are in place that make it impossible to think that way. We've got too many restrictions on doing things that make common sense. When the governor of Wyoming wants to send one of his C-130s with the Guard members on board to California to help fight wildfires, he's probably got the airplanes parked on the ramp. He might not have enough crews to send them all when he gets the phone call from the governor of California. There's an active duty associate sitting there in the unit with active duty crew members who are fully qualified in the mission, but he can't send them. That makes no sense. And you'd think it'd be as easy as a phone call to the Secretary of the Air Force or to me and say, I want to send him, and we'd say, go. Nah, that doesn't work either. So it takes a few days to respond, and while we're working the response, homes are still burning. We have to get rid of some of these rules and restrictions and the things that we put up to defend things over time. We got to get rid of them. If we really want to integrate, we got to put common sense back in the equation. There's reason for policy and guidelines, but some of these have grown up just to protect things. What we've done over the last year is we actually have looked hard at this idea of efficiency versus capability, meaning if we can become more efficient with our total Air Force by pushing more stuff into the reserve component, why wouldn't we? Money's an issue. If we can become more efficient, we should. But as you do that analysis, you have to figure out, as you push more into the reserve component, where do you hit an operational bumper, if you will, a reason not to go farther. You can't get there fast enough with enough force structure. You can't respond with enough in the first 30 days. You can't meet the war plan requirement, whatever it is. Or simple things like you can't keep an experienced Guard in reserve if you don't have a big enough active duty. Or if you have overseas force structure in the active duty, you've got to have a base in the CONUS to rotate to it, or your active duty people will never come back to the States. They'll always be assigned overseas, which won't keep them in long because their families won't like it. So all that analysis has to be done before you make these decisions. We have been working very hard at building a decision support tool. I'm not going to go into the tool, but let me tell you how we did it. We did it side by side. We did it with the Guard, the Reserve, the active duty, the tags are all sitting in the room. And we used the same cost model. We used the same decision support tool. We've looked at all the options together. So we understand the problem better than we did before. And then we've made recommendations in about 60% of our airframe type so far. It takes a while to do this analysis right. And you've got to get it right. You can completely break the Air Force if you get it wrong. So what we've done is airplane by airplane, look at how much can we push in the reserve component, specialty by specialty, how much can we move in the reserve component. And then the reserve components look at where does it make sense to put those things. They can recruit well in some areas, others they can't. Associate units make sense in some places, other places they just don't. And so we've got to put the logic together, build this whole plan. We've incorporated about 40 to 50% of this into the 15 budget. We'll do the rest by the 16 budget. We'll have the analysis done by the end of this next budget cycle. So that's the game plan going forward. We've had great support from the Guard Bureau, great support from the tags. When I take a POM briefing to the Secretary of the Air Force, the Chief of the Guard, the Chief of the Reserve are there with me, as are the two tags who advise us in this effort. They have a voice in the meeting. They have a say. And there's no restrictions on communications with the Guard or the tags of the States. That's the way it's been working. It'll continue to work like that, and we're going to just make this institutionally the way we do business. We're looking at deploy to dwell goals. The Guard Bureau has signed up in the future because we want to push more into the reserve component and they want to take it. They believe they can handle a 1-to-5 deploy to dwell model. We're a little worried about that in some mission areas, particularly the fighter force. Volunteerism has been fantastic, by the way, for the last 14 years. It's not a matter of being able to do the job, but 1-to-5 puts a big strain on employers, on communities, on lots of things. So we're going to do a one-year test here, this year, to the middle of this year to middle of next year, and just see if it works. If it doesn't, we'll have to change how much we push in those particular areas into the reserve component. If it does, we have other options. But we got to get emotion off the table, put logic on the table. And so that's what we're trying to do. We're going to test the concept this next year. We're doing personnel integration everywhere from fighter wings. We have a fighter wing in Ohio, a guard wing, the 180th fighter wing that was just assumed command by an active duty officer who was kind of made a guard officer on the day of the change of command and is now kind of holds a dual commission and is serving as a commander of a guard fighter wing. We'll look for opportunities to go the other direction as well. Major General Kathy Robertson just took over as our, excuse me, Kathy Johnson just took over as our deputy A4 on the air staff, deputy director of logistics for us on the air staff. She's a reserve officer. We would like to have that be the model in every directorate. So the director or the deputy director is a reserve officer over time. Now, it's a huge commitment for the Guard and Reserve because they've got to commit to qualify officers over time to be ready to handle those positions. If you're going to be the A3, the A4, the Air Force, you can't have done it 2 weeks a year for the last 10 years. So it's a huge commitment required to get this right, but we're going to try. And then finally, we should be exploiting the strengths of our components. The political power of the Air National Guard should be a huge strength of the United States Air Force. Somehow we turned it into a weakness. We've got to reverse that. If we want to be successful, it's got to change. Next slide. Let me very briefly talk about a change in the way we do strategy and planning, because to me, all this sounds cool, but if you can't get where you need to go, the ideas are cool, but and people don't take it, their process does when it comes to strategy. So we put out a vision about a year ago, which was just intended to remind our airmen that they're the engine that drives the terrain. Next slide. We also put out a concept that said if you do those five core missions I mentioned before and you do them well, then we provide global vigilance, reach, and power for America. This is kind of what we do for the nation. And we wanted to make sure they understood where they fit in that. Next slide. We also built a resource strategy, a 10-year resource strategy, based on getting from here to the end of sequestration. We called it Air Force 2023. It assumes sequestered levels of funding, and it takes us to the best Air Force we think we can have by 2023 at the end of sequestration. The best Air Force we can realistically have, not what we'd like to have. Next slide. But the piece that's been missing in all this is actually the big strategy. I wanted to have this out within the first 6 months of my time as the chief, but we have been beating the people who do strategy work in the Air Force because they also do the POM work in the Air Force. And all of you know that for the last year, that process has been just immensely painful. Multiple POMs for multiple years. We're working them 7 days a week now. I just said, take a deep breath. We'll get to the strategy next spring. I just didn't feel like we could beat them anymore, but it's almost spring. So about 2 months ago, I pulled the guys in and said, okay, you're no longer POM guys. You're now strategy guys. We're going to publish this thing by June. And the idea is that we are going to actually change the air staff. We're going to create an A5-8 on the air staff that will do strategy plans and long-range resource planning. The day-to-day grind of the POM is going to move into FM. We're going to move the whole engine room that does the accounting and the processing of the POM into the FM. It's been embedded side by side with the people in FM for the last 3 to 4 years. We physically co-located them 3 to 4 years ago. It's time just to take the lessons learned from that and make it part of the FM. It's fine. Part of this was just, well, you don't want to do that because it puts it under the secretary. We're all there. I'm not worried about that. This will actually do something else for us. Next slide. Because it's time for the Air Force to figure out what our guiding concepts are going to be for the next few years. First slide. World War II, you guys know we came out of that with this idea the strategic bombardment was the wave of the future. And after it, next slide, after a short kind of diversion in Korea, short but painful diversion, we got into strategic bombardment, we shifted into nuclear deterrence, and that kind of drove us with all the theories associated with it for the next 30 years. Next slide. Airland battle kind of sprung up in the 70s and in early 80s. Next slide. Then we went to global reach, global power, parallel warfare around the late 80s and early 90s. Next slide. And then we got into counterterrorism and COIN, and that's been driving our train for the last 15, 18 years, really. Next slide. And now global vigilance, reach, and power. Next slide. And the key for us isn't where we are today, it's where are we going. Next slide. And one more, I think. There you go. I think this is it. I don't know this is it. But I think in 2040, 2050, what our Air Force needs to have, really have, is strategic agility. And there's lots of ways you can talk about strategic agility. It's everything from decision-making process to resourcing process to the acquisition process to the ability to respond to a crisis to how you deliver weapons on the battlefield. But I think this is it. But just saying that won't get us there. So we need a game plan. Next slide. We haven't had a strategy in almost 9 years in the Air Force. We need to have a strategy that lives, that breathes, that somebody manages every day, that we talk about, that we argue about, that we kick around the table, that you guys write about, that we adjust over time because it makes sense to adjust over time. So here's what we're going to try and do. We're going to build a strategic document that really has three pieces. The top piece is a 30-year look. I think looking beyond that, we're kind of kidding ourselves. But you can't just look at 30 years and pretend like the world ends then. The goal of any strategy is to always have you striving to look over that 30-year hill and see what's on the other side. So in my mind, I would start at the bottom of those bullets on the left. This is our call to the future. It identifies the strategic environment we think will exist, the threat assessment, the strategic priorities for the department and how the Air Force fits into that, lines of operations on things like science and technology, R&D, human capital development, education, training, as the world changes in those arenas. It is the call to the future to keep pulling our service forward, because our service will fail if we don't stay on the front end of technology development, education, training. We will fail eventually. We'll update this every 4 years, kind of to align with chiefs and secretaries changing over, and we'll review it every 2 years. Next slide. Second piece of this is going to be one Air Force master plan. Right now we have 13, one for each of our core function areas. They're developed in different parts of the Air Force, and then we kind of stand them up next to each other and admire them. They got to come together, because what we aren't able to do when we do it that way, we get great expertise in those core function areas. That's been a benefit of this. The folks out there in the major commands who build these plans really understand the portfolio. But it doesn't allow us a great opportunity to trade across the portfolios, to make the strategic trades that we really have to be making as a service, especially when resources are constrained. Because we have to have the debate now about space capability versus, pick a topic, close air support, air superiority. We've got to have those debates every year. We need to be having them in the joint arena, by the way. But this is what we've got to be having inside the Air Force. And it's got to have all those things in that 20-year look. And the big thing I would tell you is attach to this master plan are flight plans, or roadmaps, if you will, for things like remotely piloted aircraft, for training education, for partnerships, for whatever it is that you're managing. But all that has to come together in a single master plan. We'll review this every year. We'll update it every 2 years. By the way, this is a 20-year look, and it's fiscally informed. So if we... all the stuff we know we're doing in that 20-year period, the numbers are factored in for spending. Anything new we propose, those numbers have to be factored in for spending. And we're going to look at the budget projections, and if they go above that line, you can't add it. Right now, we have a plan in the mid-20s and beyond that we can't, it's a pipe dream. We can't afford it. So what are we really going to prioritize? So that Congress understands, so the Department of Defense understands, so there's a real clear understanding of where we're going as a service, and over time we can build a little bit of trust that we're actually going to get where we say we're going, which will allow a little more consistency in funding, a little more consistency in support inside the Air Force, inside the Department, and hopefully inside the government. So that's the game plan. Next slide. And the third piece of this is that 10-year funding strategy. Air Force 2023 is this. We built that first because of the pressures from sequestration. And now this year, we will build the top two pieces. And in 17, we'll go through the whole cycle for the 17 budget. We'll have the whole thing in place. But this 10-year funding, this 10-year budget will be a balanced 10-year budget. Kind of like you have to do at home. And the first 5 years will be our POM. But there won't be stuff out there that's 50% above what we expect our funding line to be. We can't operate that way. And we have to be able to then go to the department and say, look, here's what we can afford to do. Here's what we can provide you. You want more than that? Show me the money. We just got to get realistic about how we're looking at the future. It's the only way to assess logically where we're going to be. We got to quit hoping. Next slide. Okay. By the way, it's posture hearing season. This is kind of what posture hearings feel like. Just had one yesterday. So I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have about that, about anything I've said, or about any other topic you'd like me to get into. Thank you so much again for letting me be here. Thanks for what you do for national security.
Thank you very much, General Welsh, for those comments. And any briefing that ends on a dog slide is usually a crowd pleaser, so well done on that. Particularly, I'm sure you were not equating dogs in congressional testimony season in any way, but that's also a crowd pleaser in Washington. Let me pick up on the thought you came to toward the end on strategic agility, which certainly resonates with me, and I'm sure many in the audience. But let's talk a little bit about how difficult that is to practice. And what I mean by that is you're looking at a world with a lot of uncertainty. We face uncertainty day to day. Certainly the Ukraine crisis is an example of that. But also uncertainty over 20 to 30 years is immense, unmeasurable, really. And at the same time, as you try to be agile against that uncertain world, you're facing tremendous budget pressure, as you said, and you have to be realistic about what that means. What are the ways in which you're thinking through how to prioritize in that world? How do you think about it in a general sense? How do you come to a way to prioritize against that kind of uncertainty? And what actually are you thinking are those priorities as you move forward?
Yeah, the biggest problem we have right now is that what sequestered funding levels mean to all the services is that every decision hurts. We're way past easy choices at this point. And so every decision, every recommendation you make is going to impact something dramatically. Everything in our budget this year will result in a combatant commander having less capability, less capacity, less ability to respond, less flexibility. That's what is happening right now. And so the first thing we have to do is understand that our ability to do things as a nation is going to diminish. Mm-hmm. It just is. The expectation has got to change. This funding projection that's in the law that's called sequester will actually change our ability to do things around the world. There's going to be less. And people just have got to understand that. If that's not acceptable, then we need to change the funding profiles. And so that's kind of the way we're looking at it. So we're prioritizing the things we think we will be asked to support, and we're putting the things that would have the least impact at the top of the list to cut. Now, it doesn't mean they don't have an impact. Every one of them has an impact. But they have the least impact compared to the other things in those five core mission areas we have to provide. The biggest danger is that the event of the day, the crisis of the day, the contingency of the day, will drive you to focus way too much on any one of those mission areas to the exclusion of others. An example would be for the last 14 years, we've been doing close air support. That's all anybody here really knows the Air Force has been doing in Afghanistan and Iraq. We've been doing all that other stuff, by the way, but you don't see all that stuff. But most people just know about close air support. So the concern right now is you can't cut close air support. Well, compared to the other things you would have to cut, it's actually the right choice if you're worried about fighting a large conflict in the future. If you're not worried about that and the nation decides that the optimal approach should be to get ready for a counterinsurgency fight, we would change what we prioritize. But that's not why superpowers have air forces. They have an air force to fight a full spectrum, high-end fight if it should be required. And so we are optimizing to be able to do that, and we can do a counterinsurgency support with the things that do that. But it's not optimized for that. But that's the kind of debate we're in right now. Mm-hmm. The other debate is, how do you balance readiness today versus capability and capacity over time? If you're an Air Force, can you not modernize and just keep more old stuff because it's cheaper? You can, and it helps you for a couple of years, and then it's a real problem. 10 years from now, the older stuff won't be competitive in the battle space. Just won't be. You can wish it was, but it won't be. And so one of my jobs is to make sure that we take a very realistic look at this and give an honest assessment of best military advice of what we need. So you get into modernization being not an optional thing for the Air Force. We have to modernize. And then you talk about, do you recapitalize or do you modernize? Do you just upgrade old stuff or do you recapitalize by buying new? And there's some areas you've got to buy new. You can't dress up a fourth generation airplane or legacy fighters and make it competitive with an F-35. Can't be done. Again, we'd like to do it because it'd be a lot cheaper. Can't be done. And so the real question for me in that kind of discussion is, do I want to look the moms and dads of America in the eye and say, it's okay that your son and daughter will be flying that older airplane? Because they're really good, and we'll win the war anyway. More of them will die. I'm not willing to have that conversation. The number one superpower in the world shouldn't.
the issue of balance is one that's throughout the department's communications in this budget season and in this QDR season. And Secretary James also mentioned it yesterday, exactly as you just did, on the underscoring the need to balance readiness and future capabilities when she testified yesterday. What is your sense of how well you are able to achieve that balance, or how did you do the balance as you look out across the pond that you've just submitted?
We actually looked at everything as an option. We looked at every modernization program. We started with a recapitalization discussion. What do you have to recapitalize? And there's lots of details behind it, but we decided on the F-35, the KC-46, and the long-range strike bomber for operational reasons. And I'd be glad to go into them in more detail, but I'll save that in case you're not interested. But those were the big three. Those are expensive. And so we then had to look at every other modernization program and figure out what we couldn't afford, and we cut about 50% of them. The ones we kept were the things that were absolutely required to keep an aircraft or a system viable against a future threat or against future technology. As an example, we don't have enough F-22s to do air superiority on a theater scale because they were capped at 187, which means we have to support them with something else to do that. Today, it would be the F-15C. The F-15C radar needs to be upgraded, or it's not going to be competitive even against today's threat in some scenarios. So that's a case where we will upgrade that radar. We have to. But we're going to cut the overall fleet because we can't afford to do both. And so those are the decisions we're making. And then we prioritize by looking at what a combatant commander needs in a major air fight. And all those five mission areas I talked about, and we tried to balance those in a way that we could provide the combatant commander the support they would need in that conflict, although it wouldn't be enough capacity in any one area, we could do every mission that they needed us to do. That was the balance. And we did a lot of operational analysis on this and compared different options. You know, is it better to cut A-10s? Is it better to cut more F-16s? Is it better to cut F-15s or B-1s or just buy less F-35s? And we looked at all that versus an operational analysis that's pretty detailed, and that's how we came to our decisions.
How confident are you in our ability for the Air Force to track readiness accurately, to have a good sense in a timely manner of how ready the force is so we can adjust as necessary?
Yeah, we're really confident in that. We do this every single day. Our squadrons are assessed, literally weekly, and we wrap up reports monthly. Readiness has been declining for us for a long time. The war in Afghanistan and Iraq has drawn a lot of the training time, especially the full spectrum training that we would like to do more of in the Air Force to do all the missions that we're kind of tasked against. We haven't had as much of that, especially since about 2003. As a result, we have not had people go to red flag as often as we'd like, for example. We do not do as much full-spectrum, high-end, contested-type training. And so our readiness has kind of slowly declined for about the last 10, 11 years, very noticeably. Before, it declined for about 10 years before that, because we never really left the desert after 1990-91. And so all that has had an effect over time. The decreased funding lines have meant that we haven't funded our training ranges as well as we would have liked to. We haven't funded live virtual constructive simulation capabilities the way we would have liked to. We've taken money out of training time for pilots, assuming we'd be able to replace it with training time in these simulators, and then haven't fully funded the simulators. There's just been this steady decline over time, and it's time to stop it. One of the reasons we're working our very difficult force management plan here for the next couple of years to shrink the number of people in the Air Force is that if we don't do that, and the law stays the law, and we return to sequestered funding levels in FY16, we can't afford to train and operate the Air Force anymore. We have got to get rebalanced at a size that we can afford to train and operate so we are ready. The readiness model is always a question because everybody compares us to the Navy or the Army, and they say, why can't you have tiered readiness? Well, it's actually a very logical reason to this. If you're a force that has more force structure than your standing requirement, if you have two times as many of something, a carrier battle group, let's say, then what you have to have at any given time available, then the ones that aren't available on those days can be in some kind of tiered readiness. Same thing's true for brigade combat teams in the Army. If you're the Air Force, our standing requirement for bomber squadrons is more than our number of bomber squadrons. Our standing requirement for fighter squadrons is higher than our number of fighter squadrons. And our standing requirement for ISR is way above the amount of ISR platforms we have. You can either buy more force structure and let us go to a tiered readiness model, which costs a lot more money than just funding readiness of the fleet you have. So for us, we're either ready or we're not. By the way, the Marine Corps, about the same model.
Let's Let's talk a little bit about that, the high end that you referenced there in the readiness decline that you've experienced, and in particular talk a little bit about the Pacific rebalance, which is something that's been a core tenet of the strategy for some time now and articulated since 2012 and then again in this QDR. How are you looking from an Air Force perspective at supporting the Pacific rebalance, both in terms of the high-end capabilities, but also in terms of engaging throughout Asia and a posture, any other aspects to it that come to mind?
You know, from an Air Force perspective, the Pacific rebalance has, in practical terms, been happening for 20 years. We have about the same force structure in the Pacific we had 20 years ago. We have 75% less force structure in Europe than we had 20 years ago. So this balance has actually been happening for a long time. Our force structure in the Pacific never left. It's still there. And so in practical terms, what the rebalance means to us is focusing on reinforcing some things that were strengths, partnerships with key allies, training opportunities we've had for years with some partners in the Pacific, and then doing things that enhance or build new partnerships, enhance old or build new partnerships, getting stronger communication with air forces in Malaysia, Indonesia, the Philippines, Singapore, strengthening relations and training exercises with Japan and South Korea, doing more coalition-type training up in Red Flag, Alaska, and bringing more Pacific nations together to do that, which they have not done a lot of in the past. It's doing things like sea search and rescue exercises. It's changing our fellowship construct inside the Air Force so we have more fellowships oriented toward the Asia-Pacific region. It's more of a mind shift, a mental shift, than it is an actual shift of equipment and gadgets. And then it's things like air-sea battle, which is not specifically focused on the Pacific, but it's very good for looking at how you would operate in the Pacific theater. And air-sea battle is nothing more than a way of thinking. It's for those of you who remember air-land battle back in the early 80s and beyond, it was just a kind of a conscious approach to how do you make the Army and the Air Force work better together. When I was flying A-10s back in those days, we couldn't talk on a radio to the Army Tactical Operations Center for the unit on the ground. We didn't share radio frequencies. We had an FM radio, but it didn't work very well with theirs. We couldn't speak in a secure means at all. And so that was one of the objectives of air-land battle, talk to each other. You know, create the technology, the equipment, the tactics so you can communicate. And that's what air-sea battle is. It's just a way of looking at a fact that enemy sensor ranges are getting longer, their weapons ranges are getting longer, and we have got to adjust to that, and we've got to figure out how do you connect data systems, how do you connect sensors, how do you extend weapons ranges, how do you plug and play systems, whether it's a Marine aircraft arriving into an Air Force information bubble or it's an Air Force aircraft arriving into a Navy information bubble. Now, that should be seamless for us. That's what air-sea battle is all about. This is not cosmic.
That ties, I think, very much to the point you made early on about new domains, cyber and space in particular, as domains where the Air Force has to apply those same principles into the future. In addition to those domains, I want to add to this new technology or the prospects of new technology. Can you tell us a little bit about how the Air Force is culturally shifting to deal with these new domains and to be thinking about things like teaming unmanned and manned, thinking about the possibilities of robotics or 3D printing or any of these pieces? How are you thinking about institutionalizing culturally a shift into the next wave of technology?
Yeah, for us, this is actually pretty easy. It's not a big change. We're a service that sprang from technology and that has been focused on it since the day we became independent, even before. And so our people are kind of naturally inclined to gadgets, and they're naturally inclined to new ways of using them. If you look at what our battlefield airmen do today versus what we could do 10 years ago, it is unbelievable what they're doing with technology, how we're sharing data between the ground and the air, the ideas they're coming up with for how to move things around the world. Air Force Special Operations Command is a fascinating place to visit, not because they do cool stuff, but because they got cool people there. And everything to them is a puzzle. Everything's a toy that you can play with and make it more fun. You mentioned laser printing. You know, the places they live and operate out of when they deploy all over the world are places that you don't have a FedEx, you know, line coming into routinely. And so things like laser printing to them is just a very practical next step. You know, if I got normal parts on the airplane, if I can do laser printing and create a new part, a new gasket, a new seam, a new bolt, I don't have to carry them with me. That way I can carry more bullets. I mean, it's all practically based technology development and innovation in their world. And so for us, it's a pretty easy problem to get people psyched up. One of the real success stories we have in our Air Force Research Lab community and our weapons development community, for example, is our intern program for young engineers. Young engineers come in the door and they spend summers during their educational period working on new weapons or working on new systems or doing things like examining, you know, bug bodies and figuring out how can that translate into armor plating for airplanes. And they graduate and we offer them a job and they take it because they enjoy it. Now, how long they stay is now up to us. If we can keep it interesting, fascinating, make sure their job is not at risk. If we can do that, we can create a workforce that's just phenomenal as we have in the past and we can maintain it. If we can't do that, there's a problem.
The nuclear enterprise is something that we had Secretary James recently at CSIS at a prior military strategy forum speaking about. I wonder if you could provide an update maybe in the last few months about how the Air Force has been dealing with the challenges on the nuclear enterprise for the Air Force piece.
Sure. Anytime you have an incident that gets your attention in the nuclear business, I don't care if it's a little thing or a big thing, the first concern is, can we do the job? I mean, have we put nuclear safety, nuclear security, or nuclear surety, or the mission itself at risk? And the answer to that is no. That has not happened, and that's not an assessment somebody gave me. I spent time with every missile crew member in our Air Force after this latest incident and talked to them about what's going on, how's it happening, what is being done, why are we sure, you commanders there, that this is not putting the mission at risk. And so this latest incident really did not do that, but it certainly indicated that we have a problem that we have to get very serious about. And so I think in the very near future here, the Secretary is going to release some more information, the results of the investigation. She's going to be very clear about what we found, what we need to do going forward. We have developed a series of 400-plus recommendations. By the way, the Air Force has been working this hard for the last 6 or 7 years. This is not a new issue. We've done 20 studies over the last 6 years on the nuclear enterprise inside the Department of Defense. The Air Force has taken, I won't get the number exactly right, but about 1,050 recommendations out of those studies. 92% of them have already been completed, incorporated, or part of how we do business today. The others weren't ignored. The others were things that take longer-term study, or they're things that are kind of recurring things to review, so they'll never be closed. But we've already done a lot of work over the last 5 or 6 years. But like the cheating thing, we missed it. None of those reports mention that. And so you can't ever go to sleep on this stuff. We have something we have to take on institutionally, make sure that we eliminate this as an environment that's acceptable ever, and move forward. 99% of our folks do great work, so I'm celebrating them. The 1% needs some attention, some serious attention. And I'm worried about how it got to be 1% instead of 0.0001%. So that's what we're focused on.
Okay, very good. I'm going to open it up to audience questions. We have mics that will come around, and when you receive the mic, please state your name, your affiliation, and please only questions, short questions. So why don't we go ahead with, we have one right up here.
Morning, sir. Colin Clark,
morning,
Breaking
Colin.
Defense. You mentioned the recommendations are going to come down soon. You've got 400 of them. You're the training and equip guy. Are you going to change how missileers face the future, what kind of job path they'll have, and will senior people be held accountable? And names, please.
Yeah, Colin, as the Secretary promised, we looked at everybody. We did a command-directed investigation that looked at accountability, it looked at training, it looked at evaluations, it looked at all those things. Now, the recommendations spring from that CDI, as well as from a force improvement program that the Commander of Global Strike Commander put together that was kind of internally generated. They formed teams from all around the ICBM community. They went and interviewed everybody in the community. They had a couple of thousand surveys. They had hundreds of interviews from all the entire demographic that makes up that mission area. And that's where these recommendations came from. And the boss will release all those here shortly. Part of that will include the accountability piece, and you'll see the results of that when she makes them public. But all of that stuff is going to be included. There's no secrets here. And the logic behind where we go will be real clear when you see the results and the recommendations. And we're going to walk through those recommendations one by one by one. Some of those recommendations are things that may not end up happening. Many of them are things that should happen. Some of them are things we've looked at in the last 5 years and for other reasons decided not to push hard in that area. But times change. Things change. And so we need to relook. This is not something we can pat ourselves on the back for having discovered it before. If we didn't fix it, we got to do something different this time. And so that's going to be the approach going forward. But as we have been since this thing broke, there aren't going to be any secrets here. We'll tell you.
But not today.
I'm not telling you today.
Sorry, let's... Anything over here? Yes, back here.
Thank you, General. Bin Ru Wang with Hong Kong Phoenix TV.
Hello.
I recall when China announced ADIZ in East China Sea, the U.S. flew two B-52 bombers. Now, after almost 3 months, how did this impact your operation in that area, especially the surveillance operation? Can you still do business as usual? And secondly, could you talk about what is the role that U.S. Air Force is playing in the Malaysian airline rescue and search? And how concerned are you about when a flight can turn off the transponder and after 7 hours, no military radar can immediately detect it? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. When the ADIS was stood up, there are lots of training areas and air routes covered by that ADIS that many countries have been operating in for years. And people kept operating in those areas. It didn't have a major impact in that way. So that is airspace that people train in, that operate in routinely, not just the U.S. Air Force, but other air forces as well. And I believe all that activity continues. On the Malaysian Airlines aircraft, there are a number of nations and a number of agencies inside the United States who are assisting in that effort in any way they can. The Malaysians have accepted help in some areas. In other areas, they think they already have enough information and don't need additional help. Every service has volunteered to support this. The Department of Defense has been engaged in offering help. So wherever we could help, we helped. The issue of turning off a transponder is not a new issue. Where there are radars, we can see military traffic. South Indian Ocean is not a place that is completely covered by military radars. So if you turned off the transponder, you would not be seen.
Okay, let's come over on this side. Remarkably good, okay. We've got one all the way in the back by the mics.
Thank you. I'm Namrata Goswami. I'm a research fellow at the Institute for Defense Studies and Analysis in India. So my question is related to what was mentioned before, and that is your rebalance to the Asia-Pacific. So the strategic perception in India is that there's a lot going on with the Indian Navy and the U.S. Navy, but not really much between the Indian Air Force and the U.S. Air Force. So in that context, where India has been identified as a strategic partner in the DoD guidance doctrine, how much is the U.S. Air Force actually looking to establishing much more contact with the Indian Air Force? And do you, in your own strategic guidance, have a policy or a kind of an option of having Indian Air Force officers posted in your own team in terms of doing strategy? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. We don't have any Indian officers currently posted on our team. One of the first air chiefs that I hosted for dinner at my home in this job was the Indian Air Chief, who is a remarkable man, by the way, very impressive guy. And his wife is even more impressive. One of the casualties of sequester last year was a very significant casualty in terms of the relationship and military cooperation with India, because the Indian Air Force was scheduled to attend a red flag training exercise last year that I was hoping to meet their air chief again at as he came to visit during that exercise. And the exercise was canceled because we didn't have the money to conduct it. And so one of the effects of sequestration has been on our ability to work more closely with partners who we really want to work more closely with. So I will tell you, the intent to continue the relationship is still very strong. Our Pacific Air Forces commander has visited India, has continued to develop this relationship with the Indian Air Force, and we are looking for opportunities to exercise and train together frequently. We hope to get back to another red flag exercise with India participating. This is just a matter of the financial times, not a matter of not wanting to do it. over the last year?
Let me interject a question. I'm slightly amazed no one's mentioned the active reserve issue, because you address that square on, and I was quite struck by the way in which you framed that, given the experience that the Army had 2 years ago in rolling out the its budget and its plans, and where that has brought the Air Force. I know there's still a commission, I think, underway. I don't think it's reported yet out, a congressional commission on this topic. But clearly you, as the chief coming in since that time, have a viewpoint on how we think about the active and reserve. Do you think that there are lessons here that you hope to have institutionalized and carried forward for the Air Force based on the experience of the last several years?
Oh, absolutely. We have to. The commission has reported out, and they have 42 recommendations. Of those, we completely agree with 11 of them. There are 25 that we don't disagree with. We just want to look at the analysis. I think we agree. We just want to make sure we understand what the analysis says about the second and third order effects. There's five of them we think need more analysis, and there's one we disagree with. And that's it. So in general, we agree with what the commission recommended. We gave them access to everything we're doing from the time they stood up. So in fact, some of the things they recommend, we are already well down the road on, and have been working them for over a year. And so I think there's some great synergy here that can come out of the commission's effort. I think that we see the world really in general terms pretty much the same. General McCarthy, who is the chairman, met with the secretary and I here about 2 weeks ago. Before our first posture hearing, just so we could make sure we understood what he was saying in the report, and a couple areas that we had questions about, and I think there was much, much more agreement than disagreement. And so I think that's a good sign. We have got to institutionalize this. When we looked at building this decision support tool, starting the analysis that we've done over the last year, we formed a group called the Total Force Task Force. It was a two-star from the active component, one from the reserve, one from the guard. They worked on my staff, but basically reported to me. They worked for my A8, my three-star planner. They actually represented their own component. They beat each other up for about 3 months with all the myths and the legends that each of them brought into the discussion. And after about 3 months, they became the three amigos, because really, for the first time, we had officers from each component that really understood everybody else's perspective. And from there, they built this plan going forward. We've replaced them with 3 1-stars now. And this group will now transition into the next group, which will remain 1-stars, but they will just become part of our staff. We're going to fully integrate this into the way we do business on the Air Staff. There can't be a different planning group that comes up with one set of recommendations for the Guard, one for the Reserve, and one for the active component, and then everybody goes waving their number around. That doesn't make any sense for the nation. So we will go forward together. We have committed to that. The National Guard Bureau is committed to supporting us in this. General Grass has been fantastic. And as I mentioned, the adjutant generals, state adjutant generals who've been part of this effort have been unbelievably supportive and helpful in helping us frame the discussion. So the question for us is just, it's simply balance. How do you balance the state's Title 32 requirements versus national security requirements that the active component is focused on? And how do you build a force that best meets both for the least possible cost without losing operational effectiveness? That's in everybody's best interest. So we have got to institutionalize the process. We have to experience Air Force senior officers in operations in the total force. I don't think it'll probably take us 15 years to get there, but we should not have a chief of staff of the Air Force sitting here 15 years from now who doesn't have something in his record indicating that he has worked with and as part of a total force team at some point in their career. But it's almost like the joint qualification in the joint world. We ought to have a total force qualification inside the Air Force. We can do this. We just have to commit to doing it.
Okay, let's see. I've got one on the end. I've got two right next to each other. Why don't you give both questions, and then General can answer them accordingly.
I'm going to follow up on the whole commission. Mary Catherine Ott with the National Guard Association. I'm hoping the one recommendation you didn't agree on is the one I'm going to mention. But the commission recommended that the Air Force should stop looking at cascading equipment and new weapon systems to the reserve component. And I know as the two tags that you've been working with, a lot of the concern in the Air Guard community is that the C-130 models in the Air Guard are the H, and we don't have the recapitalization plan for the J models. So as you look and assess moving emissions sets and looking at how to utilize the reserve component better, have you reassessed how you want to recapitalize the National Guard and specifically on the J models?
Yeah, I hear criticism a lot that, well, we don't have the new stuff. I mean, we have F-22s in the Guard. We got B-2s in the Guard. We do have C-130Js going into the Guard. We have C-130Js in the Reserve. And remember, the Reserve component is both Guard and Reserve. And so we do have those platforms. We aren't bringing in that many C-130Js into the Air Force right now. And over the next 4 or 5 years, most of them are going to the Special Operations Community and overseas to other nations. And so if there's a decision to buy more C-130Js, we will repopulate C-130Hs with Js as we can. I was also criticized for, well, you cut the F-16 CAPES program, which is, so you're hurting the Guard. Well, it's not just Guard and Reserve. That's active duty airplanes aren't getting it either. And so the intent is for us to build a plan that modernizes over time everybody. I mean, clearly that's the goal. The F-35 bed down plan, it doesn't put anybody behind the power curve. The plan is a training unit followed by an active unit, which makes imminent sense, actually, and then a Guard unit. And then we'll go active guard reserve. We're going to do it. It just takes a long time to populate the fleet, so it seems like nothing's happening. Same thing with the KC-46. It'll be training unit, active guard. And we'll make the choices for the follow-on bases in those same kind of sequences. So we will populate the reserve proportionally. They just won't be the first unit that gets it. And I think that's correct, by the way. But people are complaining about that. That's not a valid complaint. The C-130 fleet is something we have to focus on. So we've already talked to the staff because of this concern, and I've asked them to give me the overall C-130 modernization plan, not for the next 5 years, but for the next 30 years. And then let's sit down, we'll talk with the tags, we'll show them the plan, and we'll if it's not good enough, we'll fix it. But there is no intent to have somebody have equipment that isn't going to be capable of doing the job. That's just not the way it is today. It's not the way it's going to be in the future. But we got to make sure everybody understands where we're going. Most of this is about communication. I mean, it just is. We lost trust, and we got to regain it. The sad part for me is you go out to the front end of the business, you can't tell who's a guardsman, a reservist, or an active duty member. You have no way to tell. They're side by side doing the nation's business, and they're phenomenally good at it. And then we get into these discussions, and all of a sudden it's like we live on different planets, and that can't happen. It won't happen. I mean, we're committed to getting this right. Those of us who are more senior in all the components owe the people on the front end more than that. And we owe the governors more than that. So we'll keep grinding on this. I think we've made huge progress in the last year, quite frankly. And I think the tags would agree with me.
Okay, this was the last question is right there, yeah.
My name is Everett Pyatt with the McCain Institute, former acquisition executive in the Navy. My interest is acquisition. Are acquisition questions in order?
Sir.
Sure.
I have two. One, a comment. We found in the Navy that the elimination of the Naval Materiel Command improved responsiveness and overall systems acquisition. It was taken about 25 or 30 years ago. No one has proposed replacing it. The Air Force might look at the same answer. I think you will find your systems commanders will like it. They will have full responsibility for their products and be more responsive to you. The second question then is, do you really believe the $550 million number for the new bomber, considering the fact that the Air Force is paying about $250 for a tanker and the Navy's paying about the same for a P-8?
Yes, sir. Let me answer the second one first. You know better than I do that there are about 1,000 ways to calculate the cost of an airplane. And the acquisition pros can do it all, and they can do it intuitively, and they can do it in a heartbeat. The $550 is based on what it actually will cost to produce an airplane when it comes off the line through the program life of the airplane. It's not the fully burdened cost of the entire program stand-up. And so, yes, I believe it. And here's why I believe it. I own the requirements. They come through me. We have all kinds of people wanting to add new things to this bomber, new capability to this bomber, and the answer right now is no. Until we get to a point in the program where we can understand the trades that we'd be making, understand what it gives us in terms of capability versus cost, all those trades that you got to make in every program, until we really understand that, and we're not at that level of maturity in this program, then we can't decide to make a trade yet. And so we're sticking firmly to the idea that we need 80 to 100 bombers from an operational perspective to fight a major conflict and to provide nuclear deterrence. That's what it takes. You can do any analysis on any scenario. That's what it takes. And so we're going to lose our B-52s eventually. They really shouldn't be flying at 100 years old, but we're trying. And we'll have 20 B-2s left. And so we need that 80 to 100 to get to that 8100 number that we need to meet our real operational requirement. To do that, we believe we've got to hold steady on this cost, even if it means it's not as fancy a gadget as we'd like to have. Our problem has been trying to create a fancy gadget and then making it fancier as we built it, as you well know, which kind of brings me back to the first part of your question. Because part of the reason for that is the way we have been organized in the past. As you know, we went from a systems command to a material command. Our material command reorganized here 2 years ago to focus on center activities to determine not just acquisition, but life cycle costs of platforms. We have made some really, really good progress in those areas that I won't go into now, but I'm really proud of what our logistics and our acquisition workforce have done in this regard to start thinking life cycle in every discussion. We do still have some duplication between our SAF acquisition chain, the acquisition authority that goes up through SAF AQ, all the way down through the Commander of Air Force Material Command and the PEOs who administratively work for her. And we think we can remove some of those duplications and redundancies and create a streamlining effect as like the one you referred to. There is some benefit to having our acquisition PEOs, program managers, working inside and completely understanding the center construct of life cycle cost, just as one example. And so we're seeing the benefit of that right now. We probably won't change that anytime in the near future, but we are looking at how do you eliminate the redundancies, the multiple oversight requirements, all those things that make program management so onerous to the people who are good at it, and let them get back to focusing on their program. Yes, sir.
Well, General Welsh, you've been incredibly generous with your time here today. I want to conclude where John Hamre started, which is thanking you for your leadership of the Air Force at this very critical time, thanking you for coming here today, and a final thanks to Rolls-Royce North America for making this possible. So please join me in thanking the General.
Thank you, Carol. Thanks, folks.